We are in a series of messages called The Jesus Way, learning how to walk the uncommon path. So the question we're asking in this series really is, what does it really mean to follow Jesus? Not to follow the religion of Christianity, but to follow Jesus himself. What does that mean? What does that look like? What did Jesus mean when he said that we were to repent and believe in him and then come and follow him, come and be his disciples? Disciple isn't a word we use too much in the 21st century in our everyday language. Did I just cut out there? No? Okay. Disciple is not a word we use a whole lot, but really it kind of means student or apprentice. It's probably the closest to apprentice. So Jesus says, come and apprentice with me. Come and learn how to live the life that I'm living. Right? And so week one, we talked about surrender, that there is a narrow gate and a narrow path that Jesus invites us to, and that Jesus said there's a wide path, there's a broad path, and a lot of people find that path, but it leads to destruction. And then he said there's a narrow path and a narrow gate to get into it that leads to life, and that is following Jesus. And then last week, we talked about humility, that following Jesus, the King of the universe, came and lived among us in simplicity and poverty and humility and obscurity. He made himself nothing, and yet he was the creator of the universe. And he said, come and follow me. Come and learn the humble way. The way up is the way is down, right? And you can check that message out online if you want to find out what we said about that last week. This week, we're talking about love. This path that Jesus calls us to, invites us to, is a path of love. That you cannot separate love, true love, giving, self-sacrificing love from who God is and from what it means to live the Jesus life. In fact, this might be one of the biggest aspects, and we'll see why today as we walk through it, the biggest aspects of what it means to live the Jesus life. And I know that, as we look back in history, there are many, many times in history when the religion of Christianity has not behaved in love, right? The religion of Christianity has behaved in power brokering, control, anger, judgment, hatred, colonialism, all kinds of stuff, right? But that all of that does not represent in any way who Jesus is and the path that he called us to walk. And so we're going to dive into that today. What do you think it even means when the Apostle John tells us in the epistle of 1 John, and we're going to get to this verse a little later, but he makes a statement, God is love. That's a pretty big statement, isn't it? That God is defined by many, many concepts and many things, but maybe above them all, God is defined by love, right? God exists as a self-contained community of relationship. I don't claim to understand the Trinity. I don't think any human ever can understand God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Three persons, one essence, one being, right? God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And everywhere in Scripture, we see these three persons of the Trinity interacting, talking about one another, and every time we see nothing but mutual respect and love, mutual submission, wanting the other to shine. The Holy Spirit shines a spotlight on Jesus, and Jesus says, it's good for you if I go away, because you can't wait till this guy comes, you know, the Holy Spirit. And Jesus is talking about how great the Father is, and the Father speaks from heaven and says, this is my Son, whom I loved, I'm well pleased in Him. And we see this community in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit interacting in unending, unceasing love. And then God created. I've heard it said that creation was inevitable because if God is love, love must express itself. Right? God doesn't need us. He doesn't need the universe, but He wanted to express His love, and so He created the universe. He created the world, He created humans, and He created you. As an object of His incredible love. Maybe there's some of you listening to me today, either in this room or online, and you've never heard someone tell you that the God of the universe that created everything, that spoke it all into existence, loves you with an everlasting love. But you need to hear it today. So, Jesus, God created us out of love. We rejected His love by turning away from Him. Landed us in a whole lot of hot water, right? But God's love wouldn't stop. We sang it this morning that he was not okay to watch us live without Him, and so He came. He came. And what do the Scriptures tell us were the motivation of Him coming? For God so loved the world. Not for God so hated the world, or God so was angry at the world, or God so whatever we want to fill in that blank, but God so loved the world that He came pursuing us, right? Jesus, as He lived among us, lived love and taught us and showed us His path. And so Jesus taught us. First of all, that we were to love God, right? To love our neighbor. Mark 12:28-31 says, one of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, of all the commandments, which is the most important? The most important one, answered Jesus, is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Summing up all of the Old Testament, summing up all of the wisdom that he taught while he walked on this earth, he said the greatest things you can do on this planet is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And then the night before Jesus went to the cross, he said, a new commandment I give you. Right? I gave you two. Now I'm going to give you one more. Love. Love one another. Right? As the body of Christ, as the family of God, as those who are in, who are brothers and sisters with one another. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this will all know that you are my disciples if you love one another. That's a pretty huge statement. How will people know that you are on the Jesus path? How will they know that you are his disciples, his apprentices, if you love like he loved? Right? If we love like he loved. The one thing that he said would mark us, not that we would correct like he corrected, or teach like he taught, or judge like he judged, or memorize scripture like he memorized scripture, but that we would love like he loved. And then we also heard him say in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, you have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. If we want to be godly, godlike, then we will love even our enemies, Jesus said. We'll come back to that verse in a minute, but look at that list. Anybody left out? I think this covers everybody, doesn't it? Love God, love our neighbor, love our brothers and sisters, and even love our enemies. I think Jesus was trying to tell us that our posture in this world as his followers is and always should be a posture of love. If we're going to walk the Jesus path, we have to be willing to love everyone. Now, some people that's harder than others, right? I get that. For some people, it's a process of learning, God, how do I possibly love that person who did that to me? God's not waiting over the smite button, waiting to smite you if you don't instantaneously love your enemies, but Jesus calls us to come and learn from him, come and be his apprentices, his disciples, and learn how to love even our enemies. We're called to love people of every race, religion, sexual orientation, gender identity, social status. I don't care who it is. We are called to love. That you may be children of your Father in heaven. The scripture, that passage goes on to say, Jesus goes on to say, he causes the sun up in the sky to rise on the evil and the good. He sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Right? In an agricultural society, those two things were everything. Right? Getting enough sun, getting enough rain, that's everything. Right? So Jesus is saying the Father takes care of people not dependent on how they behave, not dependent on how good they are. His love is consistent. Jesus says, if you love those who love you, what reward will you get? I mean, that's easy to do, right? If you love those who love you, everybody does that. He says, even the tax collectors do that. Now, if we're going to understand who the tax collectors are, right? They're not just people who work for CRA. But in that culture, these people were against their own nation. They were working for the thugs, right? The Roman Empire. They extorted people and took more taxes than they were supposed to. We might think of them more like, I don't know, a gang, Hell's Angels, right? Now, if you are a member of Hell's Angels, you are safe, you are protected, you are taken care of, you are loved, you are appreciated. Everybody that's your brothers in the gang, they've got your six. You know, they've got your back. And Jesus is saying to love somebody who loves you is, you know, that doesn't make us really any better than Hell's Angels. Do not the pagans do that, he says. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now, I've heard that verse plucked out of its context, right? Understanding the Bible is all about context. It's all about understanding what the verse means in the chapter, what the chapter means in the book, what the book means in the whole story, right? I've heard that verse, be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect, and had people throw it around like, you know, demanding moral perfection from everyone. And that's not even the context or what this verse is saying at all. And in fact, the word perfect that's translated perfect here has a range of meanings. It could be, yes, it can be perfect. It can also be complete. It can mean fulfilling the purpose for which something was created. It can mean consistent with your character. And I would suggest that what Jesus is saying here, be perfect, love perfectly, right? Love perfectly, be perfect in your love, even as your heavenly Father is perfect, consistent in the way he loves. Not loving some and hating others. Not being kind to some and despising others. But loving consistently. Right? If God only loved good people or perfect people, he would have no one to love. Right? Right? You put on a good face when you walk in here, but I know you're not perfect. Right? Neither am I. But Scripture says in Romans 5:8 that God demonstrates his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The demonstration of God's love was that Jesus died for turkeys like you and me. While we were still shaking our fist at God and telling him where to go, he died for us because of his love for us. Some of us cringe at the idea of loving everyone. You're thinking, you can't just love people who do wicked and sinful things. You have to tell them they're wicked and sinful. If you just love them, they'll think that you're okay with what they do, you know? You can't just be nice to them. It seems that far too many Christians feel the need to be the morality police of the universe. And feel it's their duty to tell everyone, everywhere, all the time what they're doing wrong. And if they just love people where they're at and as they are, they feel like they'll be violating the gospel somehow. But last time I checked, it is the Holy Spirit's job to convict the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. I guarantee you, he hasn't quit. There are no vacancies, no job vacancies there. He doesn't need your help, right? Are there moments when he may want you to come alongside someone in their journey to speak truth to them? Yeah, maybe. That doesn't negate our first calling of love. So we're instructed in Ephesians 4:15, it says, speak the truth in love. Right? If there's truth that we need to speak to someone, then we do it motivated by love, bathed in prayer, and humbly and kindly. Loving does not mean, well, let me say this. So that speak the truth in love was written in the context of our relationships in the family of God. Those who know Christ. Maybe we could say those who, quote unquote, know better, right? Those who are on the journey. But we are not the morality police of the world. We cannot expect people who don't know Jesus to behave like people who follow him. They need to encounter the love and mercy of Jesus just like you did. And so our job is to love them to Jesus. Right? Loving doesn't mean that we agree with everything that someone thinks, their opinions, their lifestyle choices, their perspectives on reality. Doesn't mean that we embrace everything just because we love someone, right? What it does mean is that we treat each person with kindness and dignity as someone who is not, might be, could be, will be, but someone who is an image bearer of our Father. If you're human and you're breathing, you are an image bearer of God. Now, the image has gotten pretty distorted. And Jesus came to restore the image of God in us. But it's still in there. Every person made for a purpose. It even means that we love people on the other side of the political aisle from us. Yes, that even means Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, for those of you who don't appreciate his politics. I've heard some nasty, hateful things said about our Prime Minister from Christians on the conservative side. I've heard some nasty things said about Premier Higgs from Christians on the liberal side. It's one thing to hold political opinions and object to policies, to protest government actions. We have the right and the responsibility to do all those things in a democracy. But it's another thing to speak hateful things about a person. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, the scripture says. It's not against flesh and blood. That's not just a nice saying. It really means that it is out of bounds for a follower of Jesus to hate and personally attack other humans. Right? I've completely ignored my PowerPoint. Sorry. All right. Love is an action. Love is about how we behave towards one another, just not just about how we feel towards one another. Love is not an emotion, primarily. We experience emotion with love from time to time. Love is not an emotion, but our emotions are not exempt also. Right? So just because we may struggle to have some kind of warm feelings towards someone doesn't mean we don't love them or doesn't mean we can't love them. Our love is not defined by our emotions. But if we say we love someone and yet we have deep anger and rage towards them and cannot forgive them or talk to them, or we feel disgust or revulsion towards them, then there's a heart issue of our heart being in alignment with what we say is true. Right? If we say we love everyone and yet we are holding stuff against someone, then there's a heart alignment issue. Something, some work to be done in our hearts. To lead our emotions back to a place of alignment. So we need to make some choices. We need to pray for that person. Maybe that's the first step. Pray for them. Maybe you can't honestly say, I love that person yet. But pray for them. Start there. Pray that they would receive healing. Pray that you would receive healing for what they have done maybe to you. Serve them in some way. Maybe it's the person we find the most difficult to love that we should go the most out of our way to do loving acts. If we behave lovingly, our emotions will eventually catch up with us. A mature person leads their emotions by obedience to the truth rather than being led by their emotions. Paul writes in Ephesians 5, follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children. and walk in the way of love. Right? We're talking about the way of Jesus, the path of Jesus, that same hados word we talked about the last 2 weeks in Greek. That's the word way there. Right? Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, because you have been dearly loved and are dearly loved, therefore, walk in that path, the path of love. Just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. I did not deserve that the one through whom the universe was created, the Son of God, would step out of glory, walk on this earth, give his life, crucified on a cruel, ugly, evil, wicked Roman cross. So that I could be loved, forgiven, and set free. I did not deserve that. There are people who don't deserve your love. But we're called to love, to walk the way of love. Back to this verse in 1 John that we started with. God is love. John makes this statement. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God. Whoever walks that way of love, that path of love, lives a lifestyle of love, lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete. There's that perfect word. Remember when Jesus said that we were to love our enemies and therefore, you know, we should be perfect even as our Heavenly Father is perfect? That word, perfect, complete, is here a number of times in this verse. This is how love is made perfect or complete among us so that we have confidence on the day of judgment. Anybody want that? Right? When we stand before God, we want to be confident that I'm in good standing with the Father, right? How does that happen? How is it made complete and perfect in me? How do I get there? Here's how he says, in this world we are like Jesus. That's a head tilt statement, isn't it? In this world, we are like Jesus. Called to live like him. We're called to live as he lived, to love as he loved. In this world, we are like Jesus. Doesn't mean we're little sons of God, like in the sense that he was, but we are here to represent him, to live out his life. We are his hands, his feet, his life extended, his love extended today. Jesus said, it's good that I leave you to his disciples. Why? Because I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. And he's going to live, he's going to teach you everything, he's going to live through you. And then you and I will be the hands of Jesus extended times billions in this world. Right? In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. Folks, if you know that you are in Christ, you are forgiven, you are set free, you are a child of the living God, you are in relationship with the Father, punishment has been taken. Jesus took it all. There's none left for you. Right? You don't need to fear it. You don't need to wonder when the shoe's going to drop. You don't need to wonder when God's going to hit the smite button. He already did, and Jesus took it. Right? So we don't need to fear in our relationship with God because Jesus has brought us into perfect relationship with the Father. And perfect love drives out fear. I think that also means so we can know, we can be free of fear in our relationship with God because we know Jesus has taken it all and we are safe in the Father's hands. Does that make sense? So who's safe in your hands? Are you able to love fearlessly because you have been set free from fear by the love of God? Are people safe in your hands? We are like Jesus in this world. The one who fears is not made perfect in love, right? If we're still walking around with fear, then we don't really understand how much the Father loves us. How safe we are in His hands. We love, same passage continues on, we love because He first loved us. Right? I don't have the strength, the courage, the ability to love the people that God puts in front of my path in my own strength. I love because He first loved me and poured His love into me. He gives me what I need to love others well. We love because He first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates his brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen can't love God whom they have not seen. And He has given us this command: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. How we love humans will show the measure of how we love God. Skip to one last scripture, and I'm going to get you to stand as I read this and invite the worship team to come on up. First Corinthians 13. It's often called the love chapter. It's where love is described. Love is patient, it's kind, etc., etc. And it's often read at weddings, which is fine. I've read it at weddings lots. It's great. We ought to. If we're married to one another, we should figure out how to love each other that way, right? If you haven't figured it out yet, right? Dig deeper. I think it's a lifelong journey, really. But the whole passage starts with this. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels... I don't mean to freak anyone out here, but we as Pentecostals believe in speaking in tongues. You know, it's a way that we commune with God. But Paul is saying, no matter how spiritual you think you are, that's what he's saying, right? If we speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. Was tempted for a moment to go and smash on a cymbal, but I had to steal one of the cables this morning and it won't work, so. resounding gong or clanging cymbal, if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardships that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. So I want to encourage us today as we bring things to a close in a moment. First of all, if you're maybe new to this whole idea that God loves you, and maybe you've never kind of received that love. You've never, as Jesus told us to do, repented, which sounds like a intense word, right? Repentance sounds like this groveling on the ground thing, but it's really just turning away from my way and turning to His way, right? To repent and believe. Repent and believe, to repent, turn away from my way and trust in Jesus for forgiveness, freedom, salvation. So if you've never done that, why not today? I want to encourage you to respond. We'd love if you came to see us in a few moments when we close the service, we'd love to pray with you and lead you towards Jesus. And for the rest of us, this is a tall order to love like Jesus loves. And maybe we've got some stuff in our hearts, some things. Maybe you guys are all pretty quiet today, and I think it's because we're all kind of getting hit between the eyes, right? We're all kind of taking it in. The reality is, Jesus calls us to walk this path of love, and maybe we've got some things to let go of. Grab hold of Him so He can help us love like He loves. Because He wants to live His life through us, we've talked about the last 2 weeks, right? So I want to pray for us, and then Bob's going to come and dismiss the service, but don't rush off if there's something stirring there that needs attention in your heart. Invite you to come and find a place of, we'd love to pray with you and encourage you in your journey. So Father, I thank You for Your amazing love, Your faithfulness, Your kindness to us. I thank You for all that You did when Jesus left glory, came to earth, and lived love before us. Not only to give us an example, but to lay down His life for me, for us. We could be free and forgiven. I pray for those that are on a journey towards You. I pray that God, Your Spirit would draw them, speak to them. Encourage them today to grab hold of You. I pray that each one of us would be willing, would have the courage to repent in areas in our hearts where we have not lived lovingly towards others. We've picked and chosen who we loved and yet claimed to be Your followers. Jesus, I pray that You would give us the courage to find healing in You, to find freedom in You. To receive Your love completely so that we would be set free of fear. We ask it in Jesus' powerful name. Amen.
My heart be changed, renewed.